I'm Helen Ferreira. On today's program, what were this year's hits and misses in the Florida legislature? But first, on Sunday night, President Barack Obama announced in an unscheduled address that the United States had killed 9/11 mastermind Osama bin Laden, who had been hiding in Pakistan apparently for over 5 years. Our next guest was a member of the Senate Intelligence Committee, which he chaired during the September 11th crisis. Joining us for this segment, former U.S. Senator Bob Graham. Senator, thank you so much for joining
me. Thank you
once
very
again
much for the invitation to
on
come back.
Issues. If you were president, would you release the photographs of Osama bin Laden dead?
The answer is, I'm not the president, and I don't know the full range of things that he does that would influence that decision. I think the series of good judgments that have been made leading up to the killing of Osama bin Laden should give us confidence in the judgment to make other decisions, including whether it's appropriate to release the pictures or not. So my position, if the president doesn't think it's appropriate, I would accept his judgment.
Trust his good judgment. Al-Qaeda, Friday morning, it has been revealed, has indicated that they do believe that Osama bin Laden is in fact dead. What does that change, if anything at all, in this fight in terrorism?
No question that bin Laden was an important symbolic figure. He was an organizing, charismatic leader. But Al-Qaeda has had a history of being able to fill positions where a person has either been killed or captured quickly and with another person of equal competence. I suspect that they have someone who has been groomed to be their next ultimate leader. He's going to face a daunting challenge to live up to bin Laden's standards.
Right, and there's even indications that bin Laden's deputy, al-Zawahiri, who is now, I would imagine, the number one fugitive the United States is looking for, was in fact the new figurehead, the new leader, but not that same charismatic figure that bin Laden had. One of the things one has to assume, first of all, the SEALs who performed the military operation Sunday night, outstanding, but they needed a lot of intelligence to help and support that. You chaired the Intelligence Committee. What do you know of operations? What can you tell us about intelligence in the United States today?
I think it is noticeably better than it was on 9/11. Still needs to be improved, particularly in getting enough people who understand the languages and the culture from the region where our major threats are coming, the Middle East and Central Asia. But the cooperation within the intelligence community and then between intelligence and military is at a very high level. You can think back to 1980 when we tried to rescue the hostages in Tehran. That was a botched operation in large part because the military services and the intelligence didn't have the kind of good relations that they have today.
Well, when you talk about good relations, what about the relationship between the United States and Pakistan? One of the things that's been so troubling, and it's been part of the big discussion, the broad discussion all week long, is how could Pakistan not know what apparently seems that Osama bin Laden wasn't hiding in a cave in some tribal region of Pakistan, but was in an urban center with over 1 million people next to what would be the equivalent of West Point in the United States.
It is hard to believe, and it stretches your common sense to believe that man.
The Pakistani government really can't win. If they didn't know, they should have known. And if they did know, how could they keep that secret?
Yeah. Former President Musharraf earlier today, in an interview, said either they were compromised or they were incompetent. He thought it was more likely that they were incompetent. Actually, the ISI, the equivalent of our CIA, has had a strong reputation of being an effective intelligence agency, and the military is probably the most important single entity within the country of Pakistan. How they could have for 5 years had this person living literally under their nose is hard to believe.
And of course, this happens at a time where there's tremendous crisis in the Middle East. One of the things you really did not see this week, you didn't see a lot of uprising that you would have seen in other capitals at another point in time, that anti-American uprising in support of bin Laden. You saw none of that. In part, I would imagine, because the governments who would support that are in trouble. But Al-Qaeda's support in the Middle East might be waning?
Yeah, I think what's happened in the last few months in the Middle East is that a third path has been opened. In the past, the argument was you either had to have an authoritarian ruler or there'd be a takeover by extremist Islamics. What we've now seen in a place like Egypt, I hope, if it matures, is that the third path, which is to a democracy where the government is respectful of human rights and operates the will of the people. And I think the fact that that third way has opened up caused there not to be a strong reaction to the U.S. Very successful action in Pakistan.
Given these recent events, there hasn't been a lot of discussion of the change in the cabinet in the administration. Leon Panetta is leaving the CIA and he's going to move to the Defense Department. And General David Petraeus is moving to the CIA, which is unusual. I don't know that we've ever had anybody from the Army heading up the CIA. And some people are concerned that you have somebody within the military running the CIA. It may not be the first time, but do you think this is a good call?
The answer is there actually have been other examples, the most recent being Michael Hayden, who was the CIA director, had been a retired Air Force general. So a close relationship between the military and the intelligence agencies has been common. I personally think these are good moves. Leon Panetta is an unusually talented person and has shown that in many aspects of his life. I think he will be a good successor to Bob Gates at the Department of Defense. Petraeus knows the Middle East and Southeast Asia as well as anybody in the U.S. government, and he brings a perspective that I think will make even stronger the relationships between the intelligence and the military.
Well, and aside from that, I mean, who's going to say no to General Petraeus with what he's accomplished in Iraq and what he's accomplished in Afghanistan, which leads me to another point. What about the war in Afghanistan? The Afghanis have been saying for the longest time, your problem isn't with us, your problem is with Pakistan. What does this do? Number one, would you agree that Petraeus is in a unique position? Mm-hmm. And number two, what does this killing of bin Laden do? And the fact that he was in Pakistan do, or what relevance does it have with our fight in Afghanistan?
The first question about Petraeus, in addition to the reasons I gave, there's another very practical reason. It's gotten to be extremely difficult to get anybody confirmed through the Senate. One thing
That's
the country
point.
Can't do is have those two positions, head of the Defense Department, head of the CIA, be vacant over a squabble on confirmation. Both of these men, I think, will be easily and quickly confirmable.
And General Petraeus could, if you pardon me, might be able to take intelligence and the military into the 21st century, because as you suggested, they need to work together in unique ways because we're fighting different types of wars.
And I think this is going to be a time to rethink what we're doing in Afghanistan. We're in Afghanistan because that's where Al-Qaeda was based on September the 11th, 2001, and we thought that was where we should go in order to get our revenge for what had happened to us. In the intervening almost 10 years, Al-Qaeda has virtually abandoned Afghanistan. The best estimate is there are less than 100 Al-Qaeda operatives still left in Afghanistan. Where are they? They're in Pakistan, they're in Yemen, they're in Somalia, primarily, and in other places around the world. I think we need to shift our strategy from one of taking and holding ground in Afghanistan to one of, like a laser, focusing in on Al-Qaeda, wherever it is, and other terrorist groups such as Hezbollah, which prior to 9/11 had killed more Americans than any other terrorist group.
So for you, game is not over when it comes to Al-Qaeda.
The game is certainly not over. It's going to be a new game. There'll be a different leader, a different philosophy of how to pursue it. Bin Laden had the idea that he never wanted to attack the United States after 9/11 unless he knew he could have an even greater rate of death than he did on that tragic day. I think that the new leader may change that, and therefore we would become concerned about significant but less than 9/11 scale attacks inside the United States led by Al-Qaeda.
Well, one of the things that is being revealed is that with the information that was found in the compound where bin Laden was living, there was information of having an attack through railways on the 10th anniversary of September 11th, which is quickly approaching. So can you comment about U.S. internal security? We lumped a number of departments together after September 11th and called it Homeland Security. How would you assess Homeland Security today?
Well, it's better than it was when it was lumped together. It had some of the same problems that I talked about in trying to free the hostages in Tehran, and that is, it didn't work too well together. I think it's gotten better. It's had some good tests recently here at home. The response, for instance, to the tornadoes in Alabama apparently was very positive, that it did an excellent job. I think the job that the Coast Guard did with the oil spill in the Gulf, once they got through an early period of indecision, was a very good performance. So I have more hope and optimism for the department's ability to protect the homeland today than I did when it was established 6 or 7 years ago.
And yet first responders continue to be the ones that we need to buttress. Any movement to help them in that regard?
There's been a great deal of effort made to build closer bridges. There had been a history, for instance, of between federal law enforcement and state and local law enforcement of seeing each other more as competitors than as companions in a common effort. I think some of that hostility has been released. I also believe that the leadership of the department is now in good hands. I'm impressed with the job that Ms. Napolitano
Janet
is doing.
Napolitano.
And I think Americans can take some greater comfort in the ability of the Department of Homeland Security to actually secure the homeland.
Does it surprise you at all that there's some chatter and discussion as to whether the United States should have shot and killed bin Laden, given that it appears that he was unarmed at the time? Does that surprise you?
I guess in a country of 310 million people, there will always be some disagreement. We're going to probably have a period of disagreement now, not as to when did Barack Obama birth, but rather when did Osama bin Laden die. But given the situation, I mean, here's a man who's been responsible for killing thousands of people around the world. I think his demise was justice.
You know what did surprise me? I thought the president would get a higher bump in the polls. And there have been a number of polls, a number of Pew, CBS News did another one, and Gallup did one, not Pew, Gallup did one that showed that the president had an approval rating of 52%, and I think the highest one up to 61%. I thought it would be that much higher. What does this tell you about re-election in 2012?
Well, what it tells me is, one, this is consistent. After the Persian Gulf War in 1991, then President Bush got a significant bump. This is another example. Heroic, decisive leadership results in a favorable increase in your poll ratings. I think what it also says is that the issue that is still by far the strongest one in the minds of Americans, not foreign policy, it's the economy, or as Bill Clinton used to say, the economy stupid. And people are still hurting in this economy. As to what effect it'll have in 2012, historically these bumps have lasted about 6 months. So the question is going to be 6 months from now, what will the president's rating be and how much residual benefit will he get from this particular example of strong leadership?
Very quickly, we have a little over a minute left. You have published a few books, nonfiction. Now you're doing a novel. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, it's called Keys to the Kingdom, and it is about some of the unanswered questions in 9/11, and a young intelligence officer named Tony Ramos, who happens to come from Hialeah, is given the task of trying to answer those questions, and in the course of doing so, finds out that there's a much bigger issue than anyone had thought. At the end of the novel, we have a five times Hiroshima nuclear weapon headed towards the U.S. West Coast.
Wow, and that's always been, and so this book comes out when?
Official publication date is the 7th of June.
And when? How long did it take you to write it?
5 years.
5 years? Yeah. Oh my gosh. Does Tony make Hialeah look good in the end?
Yes.
We can be proud of Tony Ramos.
We can be proud of Hialeah, and we can be proud of the young man that it nurtured.
And do you suppose there might be a sequel?
I think so. This one is mainly about the threat of nuclear terrorism. I'm thinking about one on the threat of biological terrorism.
There you go. Senator Bob Graham, thanks so much for joining us today.